Well, good morning, everybody. It's great to see everybody here today, and what a beautiful Sunday this is today. The Lord has blessed us with a beautiful day and an opportunity to come together and worship Him. Let's stand together and begin our service with a song of praise. Join with us as we sing. Let's sing.
I was buried in thy shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you.
That's right. Come on.
I was breathing, but my tomb till I met you.
Come on.
You called my name. Now your freedom is all that I know. The old way knew Jesus when I met you. You called my chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan, but you called me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. Your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open, 'cause when you call my name,
let's give our Lord a praise this morning. Amen. 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 Thank you, EBC.
Well, good morning. Well, it's a good reminder and song, isn't it? Aren't you glad that not only He could call your name, but that He just knows your name? Amen. Well, what a great way to start our service this morning. Welcome. to Eastside Baptist Church. What a treat to have you here. What a treat to see you this morning. And so delighted to have you here in this place. Those of you that have joined us on Facebook Live, what a treat to have you join us too. And we count it a privilege that you've chosen to be with us here this morning. If you're a guest here this morning, we do not take that for granted. You have chosen to come here, and we count it a real privilege to have you visiting with us this morning. In fact, we got a gift for you. At the end of the service, on our welcome desk, there's a coffee mug, and inside that coffee mug, there are a couple of goodies just for you. It's a way for us to express our appreciation for you being here with us today. As we begin this morning, I just want to issue a public thank you to those that worked with Vacation Bible School this week. If you're here this morning and you worked with Vacation Bible School, would you stand just for a second? I mean, up. Yeah. Thank y'all for your sacrifice and your service this week. Each night was busy. It was active. It was fun. We had kids running everywhere. And anyway, it was a great week, and so much activity, and the kids learned about construction and cranes. But what they really learned was that Jesus is our strong foundation. And what a treat to be able to have them here. If I sound a little nasally, I think I caught a cold from one of the kids at some point this week. In fact, I've taken DayQuil this morning, so if I stop at some point in the message and start pointing, and I say something about a constellation or a star, Ron, you come on up, just escort me off, let's sing, and we'll just continue on. But it really was a good week, and I was so grateful to see my church family in action. Those that helped in the kitchen, we fed meals every night for Amber and Sherry as they directed, for folks that worked with the soundboard, all the helpers and all the teachers. But I don't know how many seeds were sown this week, but I'm grateful for a church family that believes in the gospel, grateful for a church family that believes in missions. And so grateful we had the opportunity to have EBS this week. Amen. Well, we're going to go to the Lord in prayer, turn it right back over to Ron and our praise team. Would you join me this morning? God, thank you. What a week you gave us. We don't take that for granted. God, thank you for the lives that were here. Thank you for how they heard about Jesus. And thank you for seeds that were sown. And now, God, we pray that you would give the increase. And so we pray for those seeds. God, we thank you that we can be here today. It's a good day. It's a day you've made. And we rejoice and we are so glad in it. Now, Father, we turn this service over to you. And we just ask you to meet with us. We ask you to help us as we seek to honor you. So we bless you this morning, and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. You ever have a problem or a concern or a situation where you just don't know what to do or where to turn or who to talk to? Well, I'm glad that we can always talk to Jesus. We can always turn to Jesus. And this next song, I know you all know it. It says, I must tell Jesus. Would you stand and let's sing it together?
I must tell you.
Voices unto the Lord, I must tell Jesus. Let's sing it together. Give our Lord praise. Amen. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated.
Another in the fire, standing next to me, there is another in the between us. Nothing stands between us.
Grateful there's one that'll go through the fire with you or stand in the waters with you. Amen. We're going to take a few moments now to join our hearts in prayer as a church. And as we pray together today, many of you are aware that as a Southern Baptist church, we're a part of a local association of other Southern Baptist churches that's a part of a convention called the Southern Baptist Convention. I say that to say this. The Southern Baptist Convention meets this coming week in Nashville, Tennessee. It's the annual meeting. They were not able to meet, of course, last year due to quarantine and COVID and all those issues, but they are meeting this week. And so we just want to take a few moments as a participating Southern Baptist church to pray for our convention. And there are several things that our convention faces, several issues that will be decided at the annual meeting this coming week. They'll vote on a new president. We need to pray about that. We need to replace leadership in some key positions. We need to pray about that. And then there are other issues that our convention faces. And so we just want to pray for our convention. So I'm just going to ask you to take a few moments silently where you are and pray for our convention and pray for some of these issues that I just mentioned. And after a couple of moments of prayer, I will come back to the podium and close this time. So would you join me as we pray? Thank you. Father's Thomas plays, we echo the sentiments of that little chorus. And we say to you this morning, we love you. And we do. We lift our voices unto you. This morning, Father, as we lift our voices, we pray for our convention. We pray as the messengers meet. We pray as votes are taken. We pray as decisions are made. We pray. We pray for a spirit of unity and of peace. We pray, Father, for a sense of your wisdom and your guidance to lead our convention. And we realize we need your help. And so we pray for that. And so, God, I pray as folks are traveling now to Nashville, folks have already begun to gather there. And we just pray that when they arrive at the meeting hall, that they would know of your presence in a very powerful way. God, I'm praying that for us this morning, that we'd know of your presence here with us, and that we'd be grateful that you have chosen to descend upon this place and meet with us. Now, God, as we continue to worship, as we continue to magnify your name, we pray you'd be honored. Help us, oh God, we pray in Jesus' name.
There was Jesus.
Good morning, church family. We're so glad that you're here today. You caught me taking care of my camels. I bet you didn't know I was a camel farmer.
Well, really, I'm not.
But we're glad that you're here today. So glad that you joined us. You know, here at Eastside, we wear many hats. Last week, I think I was singing. This week, I'm doing the announcements. And I think next week, I'm preaching for Brother Sean.
And you had better hope not.
But that reminds me, we have some activities for you that you can be aware of for this week. Oh, thank you, baby bottle man. This reminds me, you know, next Sunday is the last Sunday that you can bring your baby bottle. So remember to bring those filled bottles. Return them by next Sunday, Father's Day. Place the bottles in the box under the table in the foyer. Hello? Hey, Jack, how are you? Yeah, I'll tell the folks. Thanks for calling, reminding me. Jack wanted me to let you know that there's a student luau party at Bess Smith's house this Tuesday, the 15th. If you need more information, see Eli or Hannah. And that brings us to our next announcement, Children's Game Night, Wednesday the 16th from 6 to 7 p.m. It'll take place in the Children's Worship Room. If you need more information, see Mr. Ricky or Miss Beth. Next, there's two opportunities for fellowship for men and women. First, let's start with the men. They'll meet this Thursday, the 17th, at 11 a.m. at the Oaks. And a week later, on the 24th, the ladies will meet at the Oaks at 11 a.m. So keep those in mind and be sure to come. Up next, remember our West Virginia mission trip. Folks will leave on Saturday, June the 26th, and return back home on July the 2nd. Pretty much all the plans are in stone, but we need you to pray, because opportunities will present themselves when they're there for sharing the gospel, for doing ministry. So remember to pray, and pray diligently for these folks on the mission trip. And finally, there's going to be a special church-wide fellowship Sunday night, July 4th. I guess you're wondering what's going to happen. Well, it's the 4th of July, and there's going to be lots of food, fun, fellowship, and music, so please plan to attend. Well, that's all of our announcements for today. We're going to turn it over to Dr. Bice now as he continues our journey through the book of Acts. We pray that the Lord will open our eyes and ears for what he wants us to hear today. God bless you.
We've got characters in this church, don't we? Man, thank you, Benny, for those announcements. Oh, me. Well, I am going to invite you, as Benny mentioned, the last word there, to turn to the book of Acts. And this morning, I want you to find the last chapter of the book of Acts, Acts chapter 28. Acts chapter 28. Now, we've been on a journey with the early followers of the Lord on Sunday mornings. I mean, we have walked with them. We have watched them. We have seen as they've confronted things, as they've sought to serve the Lord. And we have been, week by week, passage by passage, chapter by chapter, talking about ministry and service. And so as we've studied the book of Acts on Sunday mornings, we've literally watched early church history just unfold. I mean, we've walked from the days just after the resurrection of Jesus to now you've got a full-blown missionary movement that has started. The Apostle Paul has been on three missionary journeys. He's planted churches. He's preached the gospel. Lives have been changed. And so we have watched as ministry and service just continues to happen. And in fact, I've shared with you on several occasions, I've been challenged as I've reread and prepared messages on Sunday mornings, thinking about not only ministry in that day and age, but ministry for us in our day and age. And at least two very practical components have come out for us, church-wide anyway, I know many personal things have appeared to us individually, but when I think about our church, two things that have come out of this that I hope we're still practicing. How many of you still have a blue keychain somewhere that says, "Who's your one?" Oh, wow, several of you. Well, amen. And so early on in our study of the book of Acts, we were challenged to think, as the early disciples ministered to people around them, we were challenged to think about people around us in our day and age, to whom we could minister. And we gave out blue keychains. Bill, do we still have some of those left? So we still have some that we could give you as a reminder. And the blue keychain literally asked that question, who's your one? Can you imagine the rest of 2021 or going into 2022 if just each one of us seated here today prayed and brought one other person? Just one. Not asking you to make 15 visits or 20 phone calls, but to pray for one. Who's your one? And so we've been thinking about that on a personal level. Who would be our one? Who's the one individual God would place on our heart that we could pray for? The one individual that God would begin to help us open doors for just speaking to or sharing with or ministering to in some capacity. But there's a second kind of practical outgrowth of our study of the book of Acts, at least on a church-wide level. God has led us to start an Acts 1:8 team. And we've got a group of people that agreed to come to at least an initial meeting a few weeks ago where we were thinking about a focus of Acts 1:8. And our very first message of this series over 11 months ago, can you believe we've been in the book of Acts that long? Over 11 months ago, when we started our study of the book of Acts, we read together on a Sunday morning, Acts 1:8. And we are reminded from the words of Jesus, when God's Spirit comes on us, we're given power to be His witnesses, right? Witnesses where? You say it with me, in Jerusalem, Judea, I say I wasn't going to help you that time, so I want to make sure you're with me, Samaria, and even to the ends of the earth. And so we have formed a team of individuals that are divided into four subgroups. So we're the Acts 1:8 team, but we have a few folks that their focus is our Jerusalem. And in the future, they're going to help our church think about doing what we can do to make sure we're ministering as we ought to in our Jerusalem. Amen for that, right? We've got folks that have agreed to be a part of a Judea team, folks that have agreed to be a part of a Samaria team, and folks that have agreed to help us reach the world. And so as we think about our study of Acts, besides some of the personal applications, we're thinking about broad applications for our church. As we seek to be the church that God wants us to be here in Marianna. And that we would be literally a lighthouse. Many of you drove by a lighthouse when you came in the parking lot this morning. And that when you leave after church today at 2, I'm just kidding. When you leave after the service this morning, whether you go out this exit or the exit on 90, you're going to go by a green sign. And the green sign is a reminder of Acts 1:8. How many of you see those green signs when you leave? They're pretty big. If you miss them, you need to see a doctor. The green signs are there to remind us that we're to go from East Side to the world. And that's part of what we see as we think about this study that we've enjoyed together. Or maybe for some of you, we've endured together. For almost a year as we've walked through the book of Acts. Well, as we come to Acts chapter 28, there's one storyline that's kind of left without being resolved fully. And that's what I want us to see this morning. What's the one storyline left. What's the life of the Apostle Paul? So as we come to Acts chapter 28 this morning, we ask ourselves, what happened next? What happened to Paul as the book of Acts comes to an end? So what I'd like to do is begin reading in Acts chapter 28 at verse 16. So we're about halfway through the chapter, and we'll read through verse 24. So this will give us a good snippet of this chapter to kind of help launch us into our Bible study this morning. So what is it that Luke tells us? Well, Acts chapter 28, beginning in verse 16. When we entered Rome, Paul was allowed to stay by himself with the soldier who was guarding him. Now, after 3 days, Paul called together those who were the leading men of the Jews, and when they came together, he began saying to them, "Brethren, though I had done nothing against our people or the customs of our fathers, yet I was delivered as a prisoner from Jerusalem into the hand of the Romans. And when they had examined me, they were willing to release me because there was no ground for putting me to death. But when the Jews objected, I was forced to appeal to Caesar. Not that I had any accusation against my nation. For this reason, therefore, I requested to see you and to speak with you, for I am wearing this chain for the sake of the hope of Israel." And they said to him, "We have neither received letters from Judea concerning you, nor have any of the brethren come here and reported or spoken anything bad about you. But we desire to hear from you what your views are. For concerning this sect, it is known to us that it is spoken against everywhere." And when they had set a day for Paul, they came to him at his lodging in large numbers, and he was explaining to them by solemnly testifying about the kingdom of God and trying to persuade them concerning Jesus from both the law of Moses and the prophets, from morning until evening. And some were being persuaded by the things spoken, but others would not believe. So what is it we see this morning as we look at these verses in the last chapter of the book of Acts? What is it we discover here? Well, that's the question that's going to guide our Bible study time this morning. But before we study God's Word together, I'm going to invite you to join me for another word of prayer. Would you pray with me? God, I want to thank you for your word. And Lord, I pray very simply this morning, as we open your word together, would you open our ears and help us to hear from you? This we pray in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. So what's going to happen with Paul? Where does the end of the book of Acts leave us with our thinking about Paul? What would happen? Well, as we've read here, he finally made it to Rome. God had prompted Paul to go to Jerusalem, and God had said to him, once you leave Jerusalem, you will go to Rome. Now, at some points in the book of Acts, as we have studied together and read, we recognize the journey for Paul hadn't been easy. Now, I want to mention something that's occurred to me this week as I've prepared the message for this morning. Sometimes if we're not careful, I won't speak for you, but I know how it is for me. If I feel like God is leading me to do something, I almost assume that means it's going to be easy. Any of you ever do that? None of you. Man, you're more pious than I. I mean, if I really feel like God's led me to do something, there's almost the corollary. Well, that means it's going to be easy. God's put his stamp of approval on it. God has said it's going to be okay, and it's going to happen. So I can just kind of kick back, sit back, and wait for that to take place. But boy, I'm reminded when I read Paul's story, that's not the case, is it? And I'm telling you, even as I was thinking about Paul this week, it occurred to me, You know, there was a guy in the Old Testament in the book of Genesis named Joseph that had a rough time. Any of you remember the story of Joseph in the book of Genesis? A young guy had several brothers, and Joseph had a dream one time. And as a part of his dream, things were bowing down before him. And he shared his dream with his brothers. And his brothers got mad at him because they understood as a part of the dream that at some point in their lives, they were going to be bowing down to their brother Joseph. And that kind of ruffled their feathers. And so we're told in the book of Genesis, they wanted to kill him because of his dream. But one of the brothers said, no, you know, what profit is there? This is Genesis 37. What profit to us is there if we kill him? Let's sell him. Well, that was a generous guy, wasn't it? Let's sell him. And they did. They sold him to some Midianites that took him on down to Egypt. And we know his journey when you read the book of Genesis and the things that he suffered and the injustices that fell upon him. But you know what his mindset was when you get to the end of the book of Genesis, Genesis chapter 50? Joseph himself testifies this as he's speaking to his brothers. You guys meant that as evil to me. God meant it for good. Man, what a mindset to have. That the things that were bad, they meant it for bad, and they did. But he recognized that more than his brothers, God was in charge, and God meant it for his good. And God used those circumstances and used those events to get Joseph where he needed to be. And in fact, because Joseph was where he was, his whole family was saved, weren't they? As you read the book of Genesis. But Joseph's story ends well. And kind of has a decent beginning. I mean, he got a nice coat. It had a lot of colors. But boy, between one point and the other point, things were rough, weren't they? And I'm reminded from the Old Testament story of Joseph, just as I am from the story of Paul, just because God promises, it doesn't mean it's going to be all clear sailing and blue skies. Boy, I got to tell you, I thought of another story in the New Testament this week as I was thinking about this passage for Paul. At the end of Mark chapter 4 in Mark's gospel, we are told after a busy day of ministry that Jesus said to the disciples, let's go to the other side of the Sea of Galilee. And so they get into a boat, we're told, in Mark chapter 4. And they get into the boat, they begin to cross the sea. Jesus gets comfortable in the boat, falls asleep, and what happens? A storm comes up. A tempest is how some Bible translations render the Greek term. And the waves are coming over into the boat, and the wind and the darkness, and the disciples, some of them fishermen themselves, who certainly would have been in storms, were even scared for their own lives, their very lives, to the extent that they go and wake Jesus up. And the question they ask the Lord is this: don't you care that we are perishing? Any of you ever been through a situation in your life, and maybe you didn't ask the question audibly, but part of what was going through your mind is, Lord, don't you care where I am? Lord, don't you care what I'm going through? Lord, don't you care that I'm in the midst of this life situation? And so they're the disciples. Jesus has said, let's go to the other side. Jesus had fallen asleep. And they're in the midst of the storm together. But you know the rest of the story. Jesus wakes up, addresses the disciples. He speaks to the wind and the waves. And you know one of my favorite verses in the Bible is Mark chapter 5, verse 1. In the very first phrase of Mark chapter 5, verse 1, it says, they came to the other side. Jesus said, let's go to the other side. Mark 5, 1 says, they came to the other side. But it was a pretty harrowing experience, even for a group of fishermen, in the midst of the storm. Boy, as I've studied about Paul's life and come to this passage this morning, as we think about our study of the book of Acts, I'm reminded from Joseph's life, from the life of the disciples in Mark 4, from Paul's life as it's described for us right here, I'm reminded of God's faithfulness. God's faithfulness. God was faithful to Joseph in the Old Testament. God was faithful to the disciples in Mark chapter 4. And God is faithful to Paul in Acts 28. Now this morning, for time's sake, I just want you to see two things. So in other words, in what ways is God's faithfulness manifested to Paul? And there are two ways in the verses that I read to you a moment ago that we see God's faithfulness manifested. What's the first way? God's promise. God's promise. God shows His faithfulness to us in that He keeps His promises. Amen? God keeps His word. He keeps His promises. And part of what that says to me is God is faithful. God honors His word. He honors His promises. And so if we had time, we could go all the way back to Acts chapter 19 and read the very first time Paul says, I'm going to Jerusalem, and then I'm going to be going to Rome. We read last week in Acts chapter 23, verse 11, after a series of traumatic events in the life of the Apostle Paul, threats on his life, by the way, that Jesus Himself stood by Paul in a prison cell and said, don't you worry. You take courage. Just as you have testified in Jerusalem, you will testify in Rome. And then we see the very first phrase of 28, Acts 28, verse 16, says what? When we entered where? Rome. Where had God said Paul was going? Where does Paul make it to in Acts 28? Rome. Absolutely. Man, God's faithfulness is demonstrated in Paul's life because he keeps His promise. He keeps His word. God had said, you're going to Rome. We read right here. He got to Rome. Consistently, when we study the Bible, whether it be Old Testament or New Testament, that concept is manifested over and over and over again. When God tells His people something, part of how His faithfulness is demonstrated in that is that God keeps His word. He keeps His word. He is true to His word. He is faithful to His word. Part of how God's faithfulness is demonstrated to Paul is this. He kept His promise. Now, last week in Acts 23:11, that passage that we studied together, we saw Jesus said when He stood by Paul, you'll go to Rome and you will testify in Rome. Well, did Paul testify in Rome? Absolutely. I didn't read these verses a moment ago, but I want you to look at the last couple of verses of Acts chapter 28 and see what we're told about Paul while he was in Rome. Acts chapter 28, look at verse 30. And Paul stayed 2 full years, 2 years, in his own rented quarters. He welcomed all who came to him. And look at verse 31, what Paul was doing. Preaching the kingdom of God and teaching concerning the Lord Jesus Christ with all openness, unhindered. God had said to Paul, you're going to Rome. God had said to Paul, you'll testify while you're in Rome. And as we read the end of the book, what do we see? Paul's in Rome, and Paul is able to preach unhindered and tell people about Jesus. God's promise. Part of the way that God demonstrates His faithfulness to us is that He keeps His promises to us. Aren't you grateful for that? Man, God gives us promises. His word is full of promises. And God is faithful to keep His promises. his word. Well, there's a second concept in Acts 28 that demonstrates God's faithfulness in Paul's life. What's the second? Well, the second thing is not only God's promise, God's provision for the Apostle Paul. How God provided for Paul each step of the way. And how God worked in his life each step of the way. Man, when you study Paul's life in the book of Acts as it's depicted here, several things really do stand out. But one of the things that stands out, and that kind of ties in to where we are today, is God's provision for Paul. And how God met Paul, met his needs, guided Paul, led Paul, and worked in Paul's life each step of the way. Now, how do we see that? Well, we see that in a variety of capacities. Now, not to refer back or try to re-preach last week's message, but when we studied Acts chapter 23 last week, we saw a perfect example of God's provision for Paul. His presence in his life. And part of what Jesus did in a moment of desperation for Paul amidst death threats, Paul being arrested, Paul being dragged out of the temple. And in the midst of all that, the Bible doesn't tell us this, but I have to confess, in my spiritual imagination, part of me wonders, was Paul thinking, this is it. This is the end of the journey for me. I'm not even going to make it out of Jerusalem. And Acts 23:11 tells us, in the night, Jesus stood right beside him and said, take courage. Just as you have testified here in Jerusalem, you will also testify in Rome. God's provision for Paul, the provision and reminder of the presence of the Lord. Aren't you grateful that we have those occasions in our lives where we get those special reminders that God's with us? Now, as believers, I know we can read the end of Matthew's gospel, Matthew chapter 28, where Jesus himself says, and I know it was Jesus, right? Because it's in red letters. Anyway, that's a bad joke. Anyway, so you read at the end of the Great Commission where Jesus himself says what? I will never, never leave you nor forsake you. And so we know that, right? Many of us, we know that. And the book of Hebrews reminds us that he's with us forever and ever. But it's one thing to read those things and at least hear, be cognizant of them. It's another thing when I'm walking through the valley of the shadow of death and I'm in the midst of trouble and in the midst of depression or in the midst of whatever the situation may be, and for those verses to come to my mind and for me to remember, Jesus is with me, Jesus is with me, Jesus is with me, Jesus is with me. But from time to time, just like Jesus did with Paul, we get those little gentle reminders. He's with us. God's provision for Paul. One of the ways God shows his faithfulness to us in our lives daily is the reminder of his provision. But it's not just the provision of his presence. It's provisions in other ways. Resources. Maybe we had a need that we've been praying about, and God met that need. I bet if I stopped preaching right now and asked for testimony time, many of you could stand where you're seated, or if you're watching on Facebook Live, you could type in stories in your life where you had a need, and you were praying about that need, and God answered that need specifically with his provision, and he met that need, whether it was financial, or whether it was another resource, or whether it was another type of answer. God met that need. Any of you can testify to that? See, part of what God does in our lives to show us His faithfulness is not only does He remind us of His promises, but He meets our needs. We know, we experience, we enjoy His provision. Boy, when I come to Acts chapter 28 and I think about the story of Paul, I'm reminded of those two concepts. God is faithful, yes. And He shows us His faithfulness by keeping His promises and by doling out His provisions and helping meet our needs and working in our lives on a daily basis. God's faithful. And that's how He works and shows us His faithfulness. Well, as we come to the end of our study of the book of Acts, we've been reminded of several things as a church family. Not just reminded, I don't know about you, but I've been challenged as I've read week by week and prepared messages in the book of Acts, challenged to think about ministry, challenged to think about service of the Lord, challenged to think about our Jerusalem, our Judea, our Samaria, and how God could use us. From East Side to the world, the ends of the world, and what it means for us to serve together and be what God wants us to be. But even more specifically than some of those broad contours, I've been challenged in my own life personally. Am I doing what I'm supposed to be doing? Am I serving like those individual disciples served? Am I ministering as those individual disciples minister? And so thinking about ministry. And we're reminded as the book closes, I was thinking about this week, I thought, how am I going to conclude an almost year-long study of the book of Acts? And it occurred to me, in Paul's life, we see a beautiful conclusion to our study of the book of Acts. What's the conclusion? This reminder that God's faithful. If there's one message that has resonated, one message that's been like a thread that's weaved its way through the 28 chapters of the book of Acts, it's exactly that. God is faithful. God was faithful to those disciples when Jesus left. God was faithful to send His Spirit so they could minister in His name. God was faithful to change people's lives when the gospel was shared. God was faithful to watch over His people. God was faithful as Paul began missionary service. God was faithful to have churches planted all over the known world of that day. And God is faithful. And what we've been reminded of this morning is that God's faithfulness is manifested in our lives in those two ways. He keeps His promises, amen. And He lets us in on His provisions. So what happens next? Well, we're finished with the book of Acts. And beginning next week on Sunday mornings for the summer, we're going to have a summer series. And we're going to be studying some different characters in the Old Testament. I'm real excited about this. Some of the characters, I think names you'll recognize, like Abraham and Daniel. But maybe there's some other names that we'll be taking a peek at together on Sunday mornings that you've not heard of. Anybody remember Mephibosheth? Oh, well, several of you do. Well, I'm going to strike his name off the list. I'll have to find another name to think through. But we're going to be studying some of the individuals in the Old Testament that walked with God and think about their character and think about their service as they walked with the Lord. So that begins next Sunday. So I appreciate you praying as we begin to move in that direction. But as we close now, we want to transition to our time of invitation. And we've been reminded of God's faithfulness. Boy, I'm grateful for God's faithfulness. The older I get, the more I recognize, as I look back on my own life, God's been so faithful. And boy, even as a Eli and Hannah and Beth reminded us of a moment ago. At every juncture, at every point, at every decision, at every difficulty, there was Jesus. And we've been reminded of God's faithfulness this morning. He keeps His promises, and He meets our needs with His provisions. So as we conclude our Bible study time this morning, I'm going to close with a word of prayer. After I pray, Brother Ron's going to be up here. We're going to sing an invitation hymn. And at that point, while we're singing, gives you an opportunity to do business with the Lord. We prayed at the beginning, as we opened God's Word, that He would open our ears and help us to hear from Him today. And I believe we've heard from Him today. And so as God speaks to you, as we sing, you have the opportunity to do business with Him. And if there's a decision that needs to be made this morning, you have a couple of ways to respond to the voice of the Lord. For those of you online, there's going to be an email address that's shown on the screen while we sing. And you can send an email to that email address and help us know what decision God's leading you to make. For those of you that are seated here this morning, there's a card called a Connect card placed right on the table besides the chest or the box that folks put their offerings and tithes into. There's a Connect card. You can take one of those cards, fill it out, give us a little bit of contact information, and on that card you can indicate, God spoke to me this morning, and you can tell us how. And that'll help us know two things. Number one, how we can pray for you as you seek to be obedient to the Lord. But number two, how we can help you take that step of obedience. And so we'll contact you and ask, what can we do to help you? And so those Connect cards are on that table. Two ways to respond to the voice of the Lord this morning. Would you join me as we close our Bible study time with a word of prayer? God, I want to thank You. Man, Lord, we thank You for Your faithfulness that we have been reminded of today. Thank You for how You were faithful to Joseph in the Old Testament, the book of Genesis. Thank You for how You were faithful to those disciples in Mark chapter 4. And thank You, God, for how You were faithful to Paul. And oh Lord, thank You for how You're faithful to us today. God, thank You for Your faithfulness. You show Your faithfulness, Father, through keeping Your promises and meeting our needs with Your provision. Thank You. Now, God, as we conclude our service, I know You've spoken to hearts this morning, and I pray for those hearts that they'd be sensitive to Your still small voice. And as You do business with them, that they would walk in obedience to You. So if there are decisions that need to be made, Lord, I pray about those. God, we give the invitation time to You now, and we bless You in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's stand for our invitation. Have you failed in your plan of your storm-tossed life? Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. Are you weary and worn from its toil and strife? Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. Place your hand. Shadows dim, place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. Christ will comfort your heart Put your trust in Him. Place your hand in the nail's scarred hand. Place your hand in the nail's scarred hand. Place your hand in the nail's scarred hand. He will keep to the end. He's your dearest friend. Place your hand in the nail's scarred hand.
Well, amen for that reminder. Thank you so much for being here at Eastside Baptist Church this morning. What a privilege to see you. And let me just remind you, if you're a guest here, really, we thank you. We appreciate you showing up and being with us this morning. We do not take that for granted, and we do have that gift for you. So when we close in prayer, and when you leave in a moment, you go out those double doors to the left as a welcome desk, and you'll see those blue coffee mugs sitting there at the welcome desk. Take one of those. It's our gift to you. It's a way of showing our appreciation. Thank you for being here with us. Those of you on Facebook Live, thank you for joining us. What a privilege to have you with us today for our Bible study time. Two quick words. With summer in Richmond beginning, we need to move these chairs just in this last section over here after our service. And ideally for summer in Richmond, we would move those chairs and stack them against the back wall. So a few of you can hang around and help us just move these chairs and stack them against that back wall. That would be tremendous. For our widows and widowers, we are trying to make sure our information, contact information, is updated or up to date. And so if you would not mind stopping by the welcome desk, Hannah Levins is back there and she has some information. If you would just look over that information and make sure we have the correct address, phone number, home number, whatever, we would be grateful for that. Thank you for being here with us. Brother Ron, pray for us. Let's be dismissed.
Let's pray. Dear Father, what a joy it is to be in your house again. Thank you, Father, for the message we've heard today. Thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness. But Father, most of all, may we, as we leave this place, be an influence for you and demonstrate your faithfulness and love and mercy that you've shown us, that we may show others the love of Jesus to everyone we meet. And we'll give you the praise and honor and glory. In Jesus' name, amen.